led me to embark on another of my kamikaze classical projects. And it has been very good for me. But I also a huge debt to the classics. Classics have been in my bloodstream since I was 11, and probably by accident. I came from a poor working class background, house, with people who were pretty inarticulate. I always have a poem which is an epigraph to all my other poems, which is called Heredity, which goes, how you became a poet is a mystery. Wherever did you get your talent from? I say, I had two uncles, Joe and Harry. One was a stammerer, the other dumber. And in retrospect, is that background of inarticulacy that made me, when faced accidentally by winning a scholarship in the 1944 Education Act, six scholarships for grammar school, I won one. And if you win a scholarship, you think, oh, you must be clever, let's make him do Latin and Greek. So I did Latin and Greek, but absolutely absorbed it greedily. And he gave me all kinds of models of eloquence I've been mining since in my poetry, in my theatre work, and in my films. And it must be 20 years ago I let loose my clog dancing satyrs on the National Theatre stage. And I've always been obsessed by the satyr play because, first of all, there's not many of them, and it seemed like a conspiracy of history to remove the low art from the high, and it's something I'm always very sensitive about. But when I was, I think, a 13-year-old schoolboy, I read at a rehearsed reading, I played the part of Cyclops in Euripides' Cyclops in the translation of Shelley, so I knew about satyr plays, and then later looked at the fragments of Sophocles' Iphigenia, which became the basis for my play, The Trackers of Oxyrhynchus. And those of you who may remember that there was a kind of images of all the opera houses in Europe always have an Apollo on the top of it, with a grasping the lyre as though it owns it. And something about that image has always seemed to me to be propriety, and I wanted to undermine some of it. In this speech, it's after I reconstructed some of the satyr in the middle of Grenfell and Hunt digging up the loose papyri in the deserts of Oxyrhynchus. And as a reward for finding, for tracking down the pattern which then had been made into the lyre, which Apollo then mastered, the satyrs were given golden ghetto blasters. And out of this, out of these ghetto blasters came a sudden, terrifying scream. And Silenus, the leader of the satyrs, tells us what this scream means. That's Marsyas screaming. They ripped off his skin, and all he ever wanted was to join in. Marsyas suffered his terrible flame for a bit of innocence. Aulos playing. The Aulos, Athena's flute. She flung it away, so I shouldn't Marsyas pick it up and play. A few blows and the goddess gave the flute she'd just invented the elegant boot. She She flung the thing aside. Do you know why? Well, think of the owls. Ever had a try? You puff your cheeks out like this when you play. And she didn't like her face to look that way. She thought it unattractive. Well, it's true, her cheeks looked like balloons when she blew. And who should find the flung flute in the grass but my brother Saturn, Marcius? Questions of cosmetics scarcely matter to one who has the ugly mug of a Saturn. It's not for good looks that us Saturns are noted. So Marcius blew and let his cheeks get bloated. He took himself off to a quiet bit of wood and gurned and puffed and grunted and got good. That peeved Apollo. He crossed the bounds, half brutes and allowed to make beautiful sounds. And can't you just hear those muses say, "Who gave a common statter license to play? Music's an inner circle meant to exclude from active participation a beast so crude. How can he be a virtuoso on the flute? Look at the moves on him, he's half a brute." His one and only flaw was to show that flutes sound just as beautiful when breathed into by brutes. It confounds their categories of high and low when your Caliban outplays your Prospero. If Marcias had touched it and said, "Ooh," the way of Satyrs are supposed to do, but he went and picked it up and blew the flute, and that was trespassing for the man brute. For then it would have been quite enough to have given it one abortive puff, a buffoonish ballooning of the brutish cheeks, producing a few and inexpert squeaks. That would have amused them and been okay, but Marcias, man-animal, learned to play. To have watched him smell it, test it with his teeth, use it like the pygmies for penis sheath, all allowable, all tolerated fun. Or your Apollonian goes for his gun, when it suddenly dawns on him that the swine the pearl is cast before by one divine knows it's a pearl and not some novel food and aspires beyond dumb swinitude. When it enters the culture the pearl represents, they reach for their skin-removing instruments. There's a contest rigged from the start to determine the future of high and low art. They had it all fixed that Apollo should win, and they ordered my brother to be flayed of his skin. And the Phrygian skinner, with his flaying blade, saw Apollo's punting pinky and obeyed. While Marcias suffered his terrible flaying, Apollo looked on with his doodah playing. While the Phrygian flenser slices and flays, Apollo plucks out a glib Apollonaise, and the skinners applaud in Apollo's reprise as my brother's flayed nipples flapped onto his knees. The last thing Marcias saw was his own skin like a garment at his feet with no one in it. Wherever the losers and the tortured scream, the lyres will be playing the Marcias theme. You'll hear the lyres playing behind locked doors where men flay their fellows for some abstract cause. The kithara cadenza, the muses' mezzo trill cover the skinning and the screaming still. Wherever in the world there's torture and pain, the powerful are playing the Marcias refrain. In every dark dungeon where blood has flowed, the lyre accompanies the Marcias. Wherever the racked and the anguished cry, there's always a lyre player standing by. Some virtuoso of Apollo's third violin plays for the skinners as they skin. So I don't make waves, I don't rock the boat. I add up the pluses of being man-goat, like my poor flayed brother Marcias. And I found, to be frank, I exist best. Classics themselves.